Good evening, y'all, and welcome to this edition of History and Highballs. We're so glad that you're joining us for this evening's program, History and Highballs Edgewater. My name is Stacy, and I handle adult education here at the North Carolina Museum of History. So whenever you join us for one of these History and Highballs programs, you and I will virtually get to spend the evening together listening to some incredible stories about North Carolina places and people and what makes our state so incredible. Tonight's program is just one of many exciting virtual offerings available through MOH. So if you'd like to learn more about our History at Home initiative, we invite you to head over to the museum's website at www.ncmuseumofhistory.org. This is also where you can find out more information about shopping in our wonderful museum shop and joining our North Carolina Museum of History Associates. Our associates and foundation provide crucial funding and support to the museum, which, in addition to many other things, helps programming like this evening's program possible. As a special part of tonight's program, you can purchase three books associated with the program, Carolinian on the Hudson, Adventures with Old Houses, and More Adventures with Old Houses, Edgewater, through our museum shop. We would like to thank all of those of you who graciously donated funds towards this evening's program. We do our best to keep our programs free to attend, but there are costs associated with keeping our series going. And we just continue to be so appreciative of your generous support of the museum. A few quick housekeeping items for this evening. We ask that you please keep your mics muted throughout the entirety of the program and to type any questions that you have for our guest speaker into the chat function located at the bottom center of your screen. At the end of the program, I will ask our speaker as many of your questions as time allows. All right, so it is my honor to introduce this evening's speaker, or rather welcome back this evening's speaker, Grant Quertermous, who is the Curator and Director of Collections for Classical American Homes Preservation Trust. The organization owns and operates Airmount, which if you joined us for that program a couple months ago, Grant spoke to us about Airmount. They also own and operate four other historic sites, historic houses in New York and South Carolina. Prior to his arrival in August 2020 of Classical American Homes Preservation Trust, Grant served as curator of Tudor Place Historic House and Garden, a national historic landmark in the Georgetown neighborhood of Washington, D.C. for 5 years. Prior to that, he was the assistant curator at James Madison's Montpelier for 9 years. His book, A Georgetown Life, The Reminiscences of Britannia Wellington Peter Kennan of Tudor Place, was published by Georgetown University Press in October of 2020. He holds an undergraduate degree from Murray State University and a master's degree in anthropology from the University of South Carolina. Okay, Grant, I'm going to turn it over to you. Welcome. Thanks for being with us.
Thank you, Stacy. I'm happy to be back with you all tonight and to talk about another one of our amazing sites, and that's Edgewater. So I'm going to share my screen here. Get in presentation mode. Okay, and now we're gonna get started. As I said, I'm very glad to be back with you all here tonight. During my previous lecture, I focused on Airmount, the property in Hillsborough, North Carolina, that's our headquarters. Tonight, we're going to head a bit further north to Edgewater, located along the Hudson River in the Dutchess County, New York hamlet of Barrytown. In case you're wondering why I'm focusing on an upstate New York property for a North Carolina audience, there are numerous connections with North Carolina to this house, including two of its owners, Robert Donaldson, a North Carolinian who purchased Edgewater in 1852, was a Fayetteville native and patron of the arts, who played a major role in the selection of architects A.J. Davis and Ithiel Towne to design the North Carolina State Capitol building. And more recently, Dick Jenrette, who purchased the property in 1969, and made it his home for nearly 50 years until his death in 2018, at which point the property was bequeathed to Classical American Homes Preservation Trust, the organization that he founded in 1993. First, I want to tell you how Dick Jenrette discovered Edgewater, which he later called the love of my life, architecturally speaking. One Saturday in late September of 1969, Dick Jenrette and Bill Thompson were exploring Dutchess County, New York, using the Harold Eberline and Cortland Hubbard's Historic Houses of the Hudson Valley as a guidebook. Intrigued by this image of Edgewater that appears in the book, they soon found it, trespassing onto the property in the late afternoon and walking down the long winding driveway toward the house. Now, Edgewater is located on a peninsula jutting out into the Hudson River, providing water views from three sides of the house. Lagoons bordered by weeping willow trees take on a magical glow in the late afternoon sun. Jenrette later recalled standing beneath the monumental two-story portico to watch the sunset over the Hudson and the distant peaks of the Catskills across the river. Both were captivated by the house, but realized that Gore Vidal, owner of Edgewater, who was living abroad in Italy, would probably never part with the property. At the time they first visited Edgewater, Jenrette already owned two historic houses. His primary residence in New York City was a circa 1840 Greek Revival townhouse on East 11th Street. And the previous summer, he had purchased Roper House, built in 1838 on the High Battery in Charleston, South Carolina. 10 years earlier, Jenrette, along with William Donaldson and Dan Lufkin, founded the New York Investment Bank of Donaldson, Lufkin, Jenrette. And it was the success from this venture that made it possible for him to acquire historic houses and collect important American antiques to furnish them. The following day back in the city, a friend from California telephoned to tell Dick that he had just returned from Italy, where he had talked with Gore Vidal, who told him of a desire to sell Edgewater. Dick remarked that coincidentally, he and Bill had just seen the house the previous day. 3 days later, Jenrette had orchestrated a transatlantic deal with Vidal to purchase Edgewater, never actually having set foot on the property prior to making his offer. And little did he know, he would be the second North Carolinian to own the house and property. Today, Edgewater is one of a group of historic properties operated by Classical American Homes Preservation Trust, that organization that Dick Jenrette founded to preserve and share these amazing historic properties in New York, North Carolina, and South Carolina, and the important collection of American decorative arts found within them. Tonight, I'm going to take you on a virtual tour of this enchanting Hudson River Valley property, looking at its history, its architecture, our collection of objects displayed within it, and more of those North Carolina connections. And just like my previous lecture, there will be trivia. 10 multiple choice questions spread throughout the lecture, which actually brings me to our first trivia question. The 1974 song Barrytown was released by this band. The 1974 song Barrytown was released by this band. First thing you probably notice about Edgewater is that it's not your typical Hudson Valley home. It features a monumental two-story portico overlooking the river. It almost looks like a house that you would see in the Carolinas along the Ashley River or the Cape Fear River rather than along the Hudson. Unlike many of the surrounding estates where the houses were built at the tops of the hills, Edgewater was built close to the water. One of its earlier names was appropriately River Lawn. The fact that it was built for a South Carolinian might explain its atypical appearance for the Hudson River Valley. In 1819, Captain Rollins Lowndes Brown of Charleston, South Carolina, married Margaretta Livingston, seen here. As a wedding present, her father, John R. Livingston, carved off 250 acres from the southern portion of his Messina estate, giving them to his daughter and her husband. All of this land was originally part of the vast tract of 160,000 acres granted to Robert Livingston the Elder during the reign of King George I. These lands were subsequently divided among his many descendants and additional land was acquired, allowing members of the extended Livingston family to possess more than 16 contiguous miles of riverfront property from Stattsburg north to Tivoli on the eastern bank of the Hudson River. On her father's side of the family, Margaret Livingston Brown counted among her uncles Chancellor Robert Livingston, who had served on the Committee of Five that drafted the Declaration of Independence in 1776, and later, as a judge in New York City, administered the oath of office to President George Washington at his 1789 inauguration. Another uncle, Edward Livingston, was a congressman, senator, U.S. Secretary of State, and the individual who was responsible for drafting much of Louisiana's civil code. A third uncle, John Armstrong, was a veteran of the American Revolution and later Secretary of War during President James Madison's administration, and each of these men had served as U.S. Minister to France. While Margaret's relatives had owned land in the Hudson River Valley since the late 17th century, her husband, Rollins Lowndes Brown, came from an equally prominent family of Charleston, South Carolina. Brown was the namesake for his grandfather, Rollins Lowndes, wartime governor of South Carolina briefly during the American Revolution and mayor of Charleston. Brown matriculated at Yale in 1806, where a friend and classmate was James Fenimore Cooper, author of Last of the Mohicans. After graduation from Yale, Brown wanted to be a planter like his father. However, his mother opposed the plan, so he joined the army, rising quickly through the ranks. He saw service during the War of 1812, and at war's end was made an aide-de-camp to General Winfield Scott and promoted to captain. As captain, he commanded Company G of the 2nd Artillery that was stationed at Fort Columbus, better known today by its earlier name of Fort Jay, the bastion located on Governor's Island, a strategic point of defense in New York's harbor that protected the city from naval attack. It was likely during his posting in New York City that Brown met his future wife. On December 23, 1819, they were married by the Episcopal Bishop of New York, Reverend John Henry Hobart, further indicating the prominence of her family. We don't yet know who designed or built Edgewater, though it's been speculated that South Carolina architect Robert Mills had a role, or at least influenced its design. However, that's just one of the many questions about the house that we are hoping to answer. The Browns owned Edgewater for 25 years. We have a few objects related to their occupancy in our collection that I wanted to mention, including a 19th century Sheffield plate tea urn seen here, bearing the initials LB for Lowndes Brown. This piece was later sent by Mrs. Brown to a Livingston cousin, according to a letter, and descended in his family until it was acquired by Dick Jenrette in 1976. Because Mrs. Brown was a Livingston, Dick acquired a number of additional objects with Livingston family provenance for the collection, including a partial service of neoclassical Paris porcelain with gilt decoration seen in the dining room that came from the Columbia County residence of Henry Livingston, and a suite of chairs attributed to New York cabinet maker Duncan Fife from another Livingston residence in the region. Three things occurred in 1851-1852 that resulted in Margaretta Livingston Brown's decision to sell the Edgewater property. Her father's death, as well as her husband's death within a few months of each other, were difficult blows. Then the widowed Mrs. Brown learned that the Hudson River Railroad was using the right of eminent domain to lay railroad tracks through the property less than 60 feet from her front door. In laying out the new tracks leading north to Albany, the railroad appropriated land along the water's edge, even constructing causeways to bridge small inlets instead of laying tracks in the high hills above the river. On most of the surrounding estates, houses were located in the hills to the east of the Hudson, so passing trains down by the water were much less of an inconvenience than at Edgewater, where the house was located on the water, and just getting there would now require crossing the railroad tracks, as you can see in this map. 80 miles downriver in Tarrytown, author Washington Irving grew equally irritated by the railroad, whose tracks were less than 100 feet from his beloved Sunnyside. If the Garden of Eden were now on earth, the author lamented, they would not hesitate to run a railroad through it. Local lore states that Mrs. Brown was so angry at the railroad that she swore she would never live in America again. I don't know if that's true or not, but I can tell you that she did move to London, where she lived for the rest of her life, where her only daughter, Harriet, was married to the Belgian ambassador to the court of St. James. That brings us to our next trivia question about Washington Irving. Which of these iconic characters was not created by Washington Irving? The next owner of the estate and our important North Carolina connection this evening was Robert Donaldson. Born in Fayetteville in 1800, Donaldson was the eldest of six children born to a Scottish-born merchant who had immigrated to North Carolina and found success in Fayetteville, a major center for trade because of its location on the Cape Fear River. Orphaned at the age of eight following the death of both parents, Donaldson and his siblings were raised by members of their extended family. In 1818, Donaldson graduated from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, and shortly after graduation, traveled for 5 months through the mid-Atlantic states. Donaldson kept a journal of the trip, and it's fascinating. He describes his impressions of things that he saw, such as the Great Dismal Swamp or La Trobe's Basilica here in Baltimore. And that could easily occupy an entire separate lecture. It was on that trip, while traveling down the Hudson River from Albany to New York City, that 18-year-old Donaldson recorded in his journal that the banks are lined with elegant villas. And he goes on to say that he thought it the consummation of earthly bliss to live in one of these places, on such a noble river, under such a government. That brings us to our next trivia question. This future president of the United States was the valedictorian of Robert Donaldson's UNC class of 1818. This future president of the United States was the valedictorian of Robert Donaldson's UNC class of 1818. In 1820, Donaldson went on a grand tour through Great Britain and France. While he was in London, he learned that he was to be the recipient of a sizable bequest from a wealthy uncle. He also set for this portrait by Charles Leslie that's now in our collection and displayed in the Edgewater dining room. Returning to Fayetteville, now an independently wealthy man, Donaldson built a hotel, which he named the Lafayette Hotel, anticipating the forthcoming visit of General Lafayette to that city. In early 1827, Donaldson and his three siblings moved to New York City, where he purchased a house built by merchant Archibald Gracie on State Street overlooking the Battery. Now, this is not Donaldson's house, but this is just a view of a portion of State Street, I should say. In February of 1828, Donaldson married Susan Jane Gaston, daughter of a prominent North Carolina judge and former Congressman William Gaston of New Bern. Back in New York City, Donaldson began to surround himself with artists and writers. In May of 1831, he commissioned Alexander Jackson Davis, an architect, to design a new doorway for the State Street house in the emerging Greek Revival style, similar to this one drawn by Davis the exact same year. And this would be the first of Donaldson's many collaborations with the architect. Susan, known to be a skilled musician and vocal performer, sat for a portrait by artist George Cook in the drawing room of the State Street House in the fall of 1832, a portrait that's now on loan to us and displayed at Edgewater. And you can see just behind Susan in the portrait is her harp, her pedal harp, and another object that's in our collection. And also visible in the portrait is one of the window benches that was made as part of a suite of furniture for the Donaldson, in 1826 by New York cabinet maker Duncan Fife. After living in the city for several years in 1836, the Donaldsons purchased an estate about 90 miles north of the city along the Hudson River that they named Blythewood, located a few miles upriver from Edgewater, and today the location of Bard College. Robert and Susan and their growing family used Blythewood as a summer residence, but enjoyed it so much that they decided to move out of the city and live there full time in 1841. Under Donaldson's ownership, Blythewood gained international recognition for its picturesque landscape and architecture, the product of Donaldson's patronage and friendship with two important individuals. Andrew Jackson Downing, seen at left, considered to be the first landscape architect in the United States, and A.J. Davis, the well-known mid-19th century architect who I mentioned earlier. It was Donaldson who was responsible for introducing Downing and Davis, whose collaborations are especially significant to American architecture and landscape design in the mid-19th century. Downing had dedicated his 1842 book, Cottage Residences, to Donaldson, calling him arbiter elegantiarum, the supreme authority in all matters of taste. The three of them really formed this trio, and they utilized Blythewood to be their laboratory. With its artfully arranged landscapes filled with winding paths, follies, and rustic benches, waterfalls, bridges, and views of the majestic Hudson River, Blythewood was seen as the epitome of the sublime. Starting in the late 18th century, a school of British philosophers led by Edmund Burke wrote extensively on the concept of the sublime, an aesthetic quality in nature, separate from beauty, expressed as an appreciation of the irregular forms of nature, like rugged rocks, waterfalls, and other features of the landscape. Now, Donaldson was clearly familiar with this concept because in that 1818 description of his evening steamboat ride down the Hudson, he recalled seeing the Highlands by a full moon, which he remarked was more sublime than if seen in the day, noting that the obscurity adds to sublimity. This aesthetic theory was also reflected in the work of the Hudson River School of Painters, many of whom, like Asher Durand and Thomas Cole, who is considered to be the founder of the Hudson River School, were associates of Donaldson's. Robert Donaldson, in part because of the influence of Downing, and to a degree Davis, saw the surrounding landscape as art, and it was. He was basically living surrounded by the landscape that proved to be so inspirational for the Hudson River School artists. At Blythewood, his painting gallery actually contained a window framed with ornamental molding to resemble a picture frame seen here in a later 19th century photograph that drew the viewer's attention to the outside world while they were surrounded by his art collection. He was clearly saying, "Look at the landscape around us. It's art as well." And even though he was living in New York, Donaldson remained active and informed about what was going on in North Carolina. The couple made regular trips to the state to visit Judge Gaston and other relatives, and the judge likely served as a conduit of information when the couple was in New York, as he was a frequent correspondent with both his daughter and son-in-law. As I noted earlier, Donaldson's influence resulted in Davis and Ithiel Town receiving the commission for the North Carolina State Capitol building. And that brings me to our next trivia question. William Gaston, Donaldson's father-in-law, is best known for his role in creating North Carolina's state blank. Donaldson also advocated for Davis to work at the University of North Carolina's campus. In 1832, he commissioned the architect to design a library building for the Philosophical Literary Society and a monument to the late university president Joseph Caldwell. Neither were executed. But 10 years later, Donaldson recommended Davis again when the university needed a landscaping plan and several additional buildings. In 1844, Davis designed additions to Old East and Old West, expanding both buildings to the north and creating dramatic north facades with tall pilasters in the Tuscan style. Davis also designed a front addition to Governor Moorhead's home Blandwood in Greensboro, making it one of the first towered Italianate villas in the nation. A few other Davis buildings to mention include Smith Hall, also known as Playmakers Theater on the Chapel Hill campus, the North Carolina Hospital for the Insane in Raleigh, an early asylum, and an earlier iteration of Chambers Hall at Davidson College, which was destroyed by fire in 1921, but a fantastic building. For Donaldson, A.J. Davis was someone who could help him realize his vision for continually improving his estate, and their collaborations continued when Donaldson purchased Edgewater in 1852. Now that brings us to our fifth trivia question. A.J. Davis's architectural style, later termed Hudson River Bracketed, was also used as a title for a novel by this American author. In the summer of 1852, A.J. Downing tragically drowned in the Henry Clay steamboat disaster, so his role of shaping Edgewater's landscape was limited, though Donaldson had likely corresponded with him about the property before purchasing it. However, Downing's lasting influence is clearly seen and felt in Donaldson and Davis's continued collaborations. And I think Robert Donaldson was one of those men who always had to have a project. He had largely done everything he wanted to do at Blythewood, so it was time for another challenge, which he found in Mrs. Brown's property. He initially named the property Sylvania, then Riverlawn, and finally decided on Edgewater in 1856. Donaldson soon began looking for a suitable site in the hills on the eastern side of the property where he could build a Gothic villa like the one Davis had designed to such great acclaim for Blythewood. However, as he explained to Davis in an 1853 letter, he had a change of mind, writing, "You will be surprised, perhaps grieved, to learn that I have given up all purposes of building a villa upon the heights and intend to live and die in this Greek temple." He goes on to say that he lacked the enthusiasm for a laborious and expensive project. And I think that's probably a sentiment echoed by anyone who's ever undergone a major home renovation or had a custom house built. However, he soon wrote to Davis again about a desire for designing a picture room and library north of the drawing room. He also intended for a greenhouse to be appended to the south end of the house. The picture room, he wrote, should be elegant and commodious, octagonal or circular in form will be best. He's still thinking about the design in the spring of 1854, and another letter he sent to Davis on March 13th includes this sketch. So not only does Donaldson tell the architect what he wants, but he goes so far as to sketch it out. And I think this says something about Donaldson and his relationship with Davis. He's basically telling one of the most prominent architects in the United States exactly what he wanted and even supplying a drawing. But again, as I said, the three of them, Davis, Downing, and Donaldson, were very much this trio that all collaborated on everything. So I doubt, you know, Davis would have been offended that here's a client who's basically giving him a sketch of exactly what he wants. The library was completed in late spring of 1855. The greenhouse, as discussed, was never built. Instead, a projecting bay window was placed off the dining room to balance the library on the opposite side of the house. And a larger greenhouse was built across the railroad tracks and probably resembled this one, Donaldson's earlier greenhouse or vinery at Blythewood. During Donaldson's ownership, the brick exterior of the house was covered with a brownstone tinted stucco, scored to resemble stone blocks. A boathouse with chinoiserie inspired roof lines and a summer house, both of which are seen in this engraving, were destroyed in an early 20th century hurricane. So these were originally on the lawn, but are obviously no longer extant. And Donaldson had Davis design a pair of gatehouses, which marked the original entrance to the estate that you can see up at the top of the map. One in the bracketed style and the other Italianate, both of which are still extant, but altered and on land that is no longer part of the Edgewater property. He also had the architect sketch some cottages, which he built for the estate's workers. And this is a good opportunity to note that we are equally interested in telling the story of the individuals who labored at Edgewater. Unlike our southern sites, where enslavement was the means that provided the labor for the household, at Edgewater, those in domestic service were largely Irish immigrant, and likely part of the wave of post-famine immigrants coming from Ireland to the United States. Between 1845 and 1855, at the height of the famine, 1 million men, women, and children left Ireland, traveling abroad and landing in cities such as New York or Boston. Domestic service became a primary means of employment, especially for young women with limited education or knowledge of a skilled trade, and it gave them the ability to earn a decent wage and be provided with room, board, and meals. But the work wasn't easy. Servants typically lived in the least desirable spaces of the house, such as an attic, and the work was physically taxing, 10 to 12 hour days, usually 6 or 7 days a week, with little time off. The 1860 census identifies 4 domestic servants in the Donaldson household, 3 of which were born in Ireland. Unfortunately, the census only lists first initials and last names, but it provides an indication of their ages and for some. I suspect one of the girls was a maid or kitchen maid, and one of the women was probably a maid or housekeeper. The 16-year-old boy looks like was either a waiter, probably a valet as well. And I suspect that the sole American-born servant, also 25 years old, was probably the cook or housekeeper. And this, I should say, this is an area where we'll be focusing more documentary research in the coming months to try to tell a more complete story of these individuals, along with the story of the owners of Edgewater. In 1866, a local reporter visited Edgewater, focusing on the library, stating, "This portion of the building is octagonal in form, and the books and gems of art are arranged after the style of the Vatican at Rome. The books occupying from the floor to a height of 4 to 5 feet entirely around the room, while the walls are hung with choice paintings. The entire arrangement of the library evinces exquisite taste and is one of the most beautiful in the state. Edgewater's octagonal library is truly a phenomenal space. The room features 26-foot tall ceilings crowned by an oculus skylight that literally bathes the room with morning sunlight. Three walls feature glazed French doors, which can open to allow the breeze off the river to circulate through the room. 100 years later, Gore Vidal would use this space as his writing room, and Dick Jenrette wrote all of his books in the space as well. As the newspaper reporter described, Donaldson used the room as both a library and a painting gallery. Among the paintings in his collection were several notable works of art, including The Gypsying Party by Charles Leslie, the same artist who painted Donaldson's portrait in London. Also known as the title Londoner's Gypsying, the painting was exhibited at the Royal Academy of 1820. In 1829, while Donaldson owned the painting, his friend, the artist Asher Durand, completed an engraving of it, which notes Donaldson as the owner on the very bottom. And there's actually some great correspondence that survives where Durand writes to Donaldson and asks his opinion as the owner of the portrait of the engraving. Donaldson also owned Samuel F.B. Morris's 1829 copy of Raphael's fresco, The School of Athens. Raphael had completed the original at the Vatican between 1509 and 1511. Donaldson commissioned Morse to copy the 320-year-old work during the artist's 1829 visit to Rome. The present whereabouts of this painting is unknown, but it was loaned to the Metropolitan Museum of Art by Donaldson's descendants in the 1920s, and luckily a photograph of it survives. In addition to these paintings, his collection included some Italian works, family portraits I've noted, including this one of his sister, Joanna, and Dutch landscapes. In much the same way that he developed the landscape at Blythewood, Donaldson began to focus on improving Edgewater, but he took greater advantage of Edgewater's location for commercial activities. He grew oats and hay in the upland fields and kept a herd of dairy cattle. And this is actually Prince Albert, one of his prized bulls, depicted at Blythewood, but again, representative of his herd. In the hills above the railroad tracks, he constructed a small chapel designed by Davis and a schoolhouse for the neighborhood, both of which are still extant. Now, just across the northern lagoon and well within sight of Edgewater was a dock, a hotel, lumber, and coal yards. Even with the arrival of the railroad, travel by steamship was still cheaper than rail, and Barrytown was located nearly equidistant between New York City to the south, about 90 miles south, and Albany to the north, about 70 miles to the north. Another thriving trade in the region was the harvesting of ice, and you can see several ice houses marked on this map. Ice could be cut from the frozen Hudson in the winter, stored in ice houses, and then shipped by rail to New York City. Susan Gaston Donaldson died in 1866, leaving Robert and five children. Several years later, much to the consternation of his daughters, Donaldson remarried. The remarriage caused a bit of a rift between Donaldson and his three daughters, but the rift was greatly expanded when, against their father's wishes, they joined the local Catholic Church, saying that like their mother and grandfather before them, Judge Gaston, they were Catholic and had always been Catholic. So you can imagine the reaction of their Presbyterian father, who, when writing his will, made sure that while each child got a small annuity, the majority of his estate would go to his beloved alma mater, UNC, and several charitable organizations like the American Bible Society and the Presbyterian Seminary at Princeton University, rather than his own children. Robert Donaldson died in 1872 and was buried adjacent to Sylvania Chapel. Today, the former church is a private house and the grave is located just behind it. Now, Donaldson's children challenged the will and actually won, so they ended up owning the Edgewater property until 1902. Advertisements in magazines like this one in Country Life in America suggest that they were looking to sell the property for up to a year prior to its 1902 sale. The buyer in 1902 was Mr. and Mrs. John J. Chapman. He was an author, essayist, and critic, as well as a direct descendant of U.S. Supreme Court Justice John Jay, and she was a wealthy heiress who had literally grown up next door. Mrs. Chapman, known prior to her marriage as Elizabeth Astor Winthrop Chandler, and seen here in an 1893 portrait by John Singer Sargent, was one of the Astor orphans, of the nearby Rokeby estate. The eldest daughter of Congressman John Winthrop Chandler and Margaret Astor Ward Chandler, Elizabeth's godmother and great aunt was the Mrs. Astor, Caroline Skimmerhorn Astor of New York City. Elizabeth grew up at Rokeby, a sprawling 43-room mansion on an adjacent estate just south of Edgewater, as the eldest of 10 children. Elizabeth and her siblings were orphaned after the death of their mother in 1875 and their father just 2 years later. According to the terms of her father's will, each of the children received a sizable inheritance and lived at Rokeby, supervised by a large staff of servants until they reached adulthood, and they were very much known in the Gilded Age as the Astor Orphans. It was while Elizabeth was abroad in London for her brother's wedding in 1893 that she set for Sargent, who said she had, quote, the face of the Madonna and the eyes of a child. So that brings me to our next trivia question tonight. This well-known New York hotel traces its origins to an 1893 feud among the members of the Astor family. The couple only briefly lived at Edgewater, later building a house that they named Sylvania in 1904 that was designed for them by architect Charles Platt on the hills above Edgewater. Following their move, Edgewater became the residence of Elizabeth's mother-in-law, Eleanor J. Chapman. And a very interesting survival that we have from the Chapman era of Edgewater's ownership is this bust of John Jay that has remained at Edgewater since that time. During the 1930s, on the eve of World War II, when President Franklin Roosevelt was at Springwood, his mother's home in Hyde Park, about 20 miles south of Edgewater, he would often come up to the empty estate and sat on the portico to watch the sunset, accompanied by his distant cousin and confidant, Margaret Daisy Sookley. Sookley, who lived nearby in Rhinecliff at her family's estate, Wilderstein, was a source for several objects in our collection acquired by Dick Jenrette, including this portrait by Jacob Eichholz of Daisy's grandfather, John Phillips Montgomery, as a young boy. Sookley died just 6 months shy of her 100th birthday in 1991, and it was after her death that a suitcase was discovered in her bedroom containing more than 20 years of correspondence with FDR and her private diaries, which were published into a fascinating book. That brings me to our next trivia question. Daisy Sookley gave President and Mrs. Roosevelt this Scottish Terrier, who became a well-known presidential pet. Actually, take my jacket off as you all are answering that trivia question. In 1950, author Gore Vidal purchased Edgewater. He described the house in his autobiography, stating that he still dreamed of it many years after selling it in 1969. Vidal used the Octagon Library as his writing room, played croquet with friends on the gently sloping lawn, and frequently swam out to the small island located about 50 feet from shore. Vidal credited the Octagon Library and all of Edgewater with providing the sudden burst of energy that writers often receive when moving into a new house, compared his move to Edgewater with Henry James' move to Lamb House, which resulted in James writing The Wings of the Dove. Edgewater also served as Vidal's political headquarters in 1959-1960 during an unsuccessful run as a Democrat for Congress from a heavily Republican district. Former First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt, as well as actors Paul Newman and Joanne Woodward, were among his supporters and friends who frequently visited him at Edgewater. So that brings me to our next trivia question. In 1956, Gore Vidal was hired by MGM as a contract screenwriter, and he later revealed that his uncredited work included rewriting portions of the script of this film. As I stated at the beginning of my lecture, Dick Jenrette purchased Edgewater from Vidal, owning it for almost 50 years until his death in 2018. He and his partner Bill Thompson restored the house and furnished it, first with European antiques from their collection when the house was decorated by Anthony Hale, and later after Jenrette underwent what he described as a conversion to Americana, with notable examples of American decorative arts. In fact, it was Edgewater that was really responsible for this new collecting focus, the result of weekends they spent antiquing in Dutchess and Ulster counties. Eventually, Jenrette decided to focus on classical New York furniture made between 1800 and 1840, assembling the largest private collection of pieces by cabinet maker Duncan Fyfe and some of his competitors. One of the primary sources that they used in making furnishing decisions was the 1872 inventory of Edgewater following Robert Donaldson's death. They studied the inventory, and for example, after realizing that a listing on the inventory of 20 Hudson River engravings was actually a reference to the Hudson River portfolio, a series of 20 aquatints after paintings by William Guy Wall depicting scenes up and down the Hudson River, they actually began to seek out prints from the series and eventually acquired the entire set. And you can see various prints from that series hanging in both the dining room and the drawing room at the image on the left. They also sought out and acquired many pieces associated with the Livingston, Brown, and Donaldson families that had previously been at Edgewater. In some instances, the objects were found after much sleuthing and research, but in other instances, as Dick noted in one of his books, they found him. At a UNC reunion, Dick's friend, Dr. John Saunders, whom he had known since his undergraduate days, was able to connect him to Robert Donaldson's only living descendant, a great-granddaughter who was actually living in Spain. So Dick reached out to her and later visited her in Spain. He learned that she inherited much of the original furniture, as well as the Charles Leslie portrait of Robert Donaldson. After hearing of Dick's efforts to restore the house, she decided to bequeath these important objects to Edgewater, where they remain today as important parts of our collection. In addition to portraits, the bequest included furniture, including some pieces from that commission from Duncan Fyfe, such as the Canterbury scene in the center image, more family portraits, and even pieces of furniture like this French table with amazing inlay that was actually used at Blythewood, the Donaldson's earlier residence, and some very important archival materials as well. In another instance, an article about Edgewater in Town and Country resulted in the reuniting of a pair of portraits by Gilbert Stuart, separated for more than a century. In the 1970s, Jenrette had acquired a Gilbert Stuart portrait of New York native Major General John Peter Van Ness, who later served as mayor of Washington, D.C. The portrait was featured in an article, which was read by another Van Ness descendant living in Baltimore, who reached out to Dick, noting that she owned the companion portrait of Van Ness's wife, Marsha Burns Van Ness, a Washington philanthropist and friend of Dolly Madison. Several years later, that portrait was acquired, and now the couple hang together, reunited in the Edgewater dining room. At present, Edgewater is still closed to the public due to the COVID pandemic, so I wanted to take you on a virtual tour. It's truly stunning this time of year. I was there just about 2 weeks ago, and the only interruption to the tranquility of the property is the passing of the trains. And that's actually one of the things that Dick did soon after purchasing the property was to have a wall constructed, and it's actually very much hidden. It looks like in the greenery at the back of the front garden there, but it's a nice barrier wall to eliminate some of the sound from the railroad tracks that are just beyond that wall. So here's the front of the house. Stepping in the front door, you're at once in the entrance hall, and you're greeted by several important objects from our collection. The tall case clock is one that Robert Donaldson inherited from his father, made in England. The pastel portraits are all Livingston family members. That portrait of Mrs. Brown is there among with several of her siblings as well. On the other side of the stair hall or the entrance hall, the Lowndes Brown tea urn is there along with a portrait of Julia Eliza Livingston, a cousin of Mrs. Brown's who was actually raised at Messina and was more like a sister to her. The pier table is also a Livingston family piece as well. To the right is one of my favorite spaces, the morning room, used in the Donaldson period as a small bedchamber, but paint analysis revealed that the walls were this very vivid red color. Here are pieces of the Fyfe suite commissioned by Donaldson, the sofa, another little couch on loan to our collection, the portrait of Susan Gaston Donaldson, her harp that I mentioned, the same one that's of course depicted in her portrait. We'll go through the door now into the most formal room of the house, the drawing room, furnished with a number of important pieces by cabinet maker Duncan Fife, including that Canterbury I mentioned, made for Robert Donaldson, a great Duncan Fife sofa that's there, two other card tables on the far wall, and the pair of pier tables to the right are actually made by Lanyue, one of Fife's New York competitors. Over the mantle is Charles Pill Polk's 1790 portrait of George Washington before Nassau Hall, which actually brings me to our next trivia question. In the Charles Pill Polk portrait, George Washington is depicted in front of Nassau Hall, the oldest building on this college's campus. So resuming our tour, we're going to turn right from the drawing room and we'll step into that hyphen that A.J. Davis appended to the house to attach the octagon library. Today it holds a bar and a powder room. Stepping through the pocket doors, you're in the library. Focusing briefly on some of the objects in this space, the portraits on the wall are Henry Clay and Edward Livingston, Mrs. Brown's uncle, who I mentioned earlier. There's that bust of John Jay. And the cabinets feature a number of books formerly owned by the Donaldsons, as well as many first editions of Gore Vidal's novels and other writings. I think one of my favorite places in the library is this desk, which is an amazing place to sit and write. This is Dick's desk where he would sit, and actually he remarked that he wrote all of his books sitting here. But the desk is actually a Colonial Revival copy of the desk that George Washington used as president. The original is now in New York City Hall. Going back through the drawing room, through a set of pocket doors, and you're at once in the dining room with the Livingston chairs by Duncan Fife, a pair of serving tables also by Duncan Fife, Robert Donaldson's portrait that I mentioned, there's that Livingston porcelain on the sideboard, and the Van Ness portraits by Gilbert Stuart on the far wall. And just beyond the dining room, you can actually see there's that bay window. It's actually that walk-in bay window, a perfect little breakfast nook. And this was always one of Dick Jenrette's favorite places in the house, because sitting in this room, you literally feel like you're sitting outside because it's this glass room and you feel like you're completely just surrounded by the landscape. Exiting that room, you're back in the stair hall, and now we can go upstairs. Climbing the stairs to the second floor, the first room you encounter is the master bedroom. Both the master and the guest bedroom are on the west side of the house, facing the river. And in every one of his houses, Dick Jenrette always had his master bedroom decorated in UNC blue, that Carolina blue that he liked so much. So you can see that here. And the room has an amazing view, looking out with these two weeping willow trees to the Hudson beyond. In 1982, Edgewater was featured on the cover of Antiques magazine. And several years later, when this portrait was painted of Dick in the dining room downstairs, excuse me, that's the drawing room downstairs, he's actually holding that copy of Antiques that features Edgewater on the cover. Here's the guest bedroom that also faces the river and features a northern view of the Octagon Library skylight. The third floor was likely servant spaces and storage spaces, and today houses a library of more than 20,000 volumes. Dick's partner, Bill Thompson, felt that every house should have a well-appointed library, and this is a very impressive collection. It's fiction, it's nonfiction, it's decorative arts, it's Hudson River regional history. It's just, it's a great collection. And that actually brings me to our final trivia question tonight. One of the 20,000 books found in this library is a first edition of this Truman Capote novella. The personalized inscription reads, "To Holly's Friend," and this provides a clue about which book it is. So I'm gonna let you use that clue and guess which Truman Capote novel it is. So now that we've explored the house, let's go outside and look at the grounds. The Edgewater landscape has certainly been an important and influential part of the property for all of its owners, and each modified it to some degree while respecting what was done previously by earlier owners. The alley of black locust trees was likely purposefully planted in the 19th century on the lawn to frame the views of the river and mountains beyond, a practice done on several of the other Livingston estates in the region. At Edgewater, the architecture and the landscape exist in this very symbiotic relationship. There are water views from nearly every room in the house, and the rooms along the western side of the house facing the river feature multiple sets of French doors that can open, providing direct access to the portico and allow the landscape to really come into the house. The gently sloping lawn meanders toward the river, and these massive weeping willow and weeping birch trees sort of dip their leaves in the river as it flows by. Each owner left their architectural signature on the property as well. In 1854, of course, Robert Donaldson had the Octagon Library added on to the house, and in much the same way, two of Dick Jenrette's many contributions were two additional neoclassical buildings added to the site in 1997 and 1998. Both were designed by New York architect Michael Dwyer. The first, a neoclassical guest house on the northern tip of the property, provides additional space for visiting guests, and it's a focal point when viewing from the rear lawn of the main house. Dick also had the pool relocated and a small neoclassical pavilion constructed next to it. Notice how when viewing it from the back lawn, a slight rise in the lawn purposefully obscures the pool when viewing the landscape. Today, the pavilion also serves as a mausoleum and the final resting place for Dick Jenrette and Bill Thompson. In a way, all of Edgewater is a memorial to Dick Jenrette, Robert Donaldson, Gore Vidal, and each of the people that I've discussed this evening. It's their legacy because they all lived in this house and loved this house so much. But much of what I've talked about this evening and what I've shared is about Edgewater's past. So now I want to briefly tell you about some of our plans to continue to preserve and use this important house and the amazing collection within it. In addition to reopening the house for visitation once we fully emerge from the COVID pandemic, we plan to use Edgewater as an educational hub for the study of American architecture, landscape, and decorative arts using the site, the house, and the collection. We also plan to partner with local universities and other cultural sites to understand the history and development of the Hudson River Valley. Here you see some students sketching architectural details in the Octagon Library. Edgewater's landscape will also play an important role in our partnership with the Institute for Classical Art and Architecture's Bunny Mellon Curricula, a series of courses and programs about landscape architecture that will focus on educating the next generation of landscape architects, designers, and students. And I think that of all the historic houses Dick Jenrette owned, he really felt the closest connection to Edgewater. It's such a peaceful and relaxing place. As I said, I was just fortunate to be there most recently about 2 weeks ago. And you really feel like you're more than 90 miles away from the hustle and bustle of New York City. And for Dick and Bill, Edgewater was home. And as I've shown you this evening, it has a fascinating history and some very strong ties to North Carolina. Thank you. So now I want to share the answers to the trivia questions, and you all can score yourselves and see how well you did. So going over the answers, the question 1D, the band was Steely Dan. That's because the band members went to nearby Bard College. Number 2, the answer was B, Ishmael, actually a character from Herman Melville's Moby Dick, not a book by Washington Irving. Number 3, answer was B, James K. Polk. What I think is interesting about that, the future president gave his entire valedictory address in Latin. Number 4, the answer was C, Song, Gaston's poem, The Old North State, that was set to music and later adapted as the state song in 1927. Number 5, A, Hudson River Bracketed, was a novel by Edith Wharton that was published in 1929. Number 6 was C, the Waldorf Astoria. Basically, Caroline Astor's angry nephew, William Waldorf Astor, had a hotel built right next to her Fifth Avenue mansion as a result of the feud over who could be called Mrs. Astor on their calling card, his wife or Caroline. Obviously, Caroline won. Number 7, answer is B, Falla, given to FDR in April of 1940. Falla is the only pet to be included in a presidential memorial. If you've ever visited the FDR Memorial in Washington, DC, you'll see a small sculpture of Falla there with Roosevelt. Number 8, the answer was C, Ben-Hur, which actually won 11 Academy Awards. Number 9, D, Princeton. Nassau Hall is of course the oldest building on Princeton University's campus, originally known as the College of New Jersey. And number 10A, Breakfast at Tiffany's. The inscription is, of course, a reference to the main character of the novel, Holly Golightly. So before I answer any questions, I've included a list for further reading in case anybody wants to read up a little more on what I've discussed. as Stacy mentioned, a number of the books are available through the museum shop, as I understand. So it's a good reason to screenshot this if you want to and add some of these to your reading list. I've also included some websites and other online resources if you want to learn more about Edgewater, classical American homes, or even A.J. Davis's work in North Carolina. A great resource for that is the North Carolina Architects and Builders Biographical Dictionary. And last but not least, there's a link at the bottom to my lecture about air mount that Stacy mentioned in case anybody would like to go back and watch that. So with that, I'm gonna end my screen sharing here and reappear. And again, sorry, I had a little bit of technical difficulty at the beginning. My Zoom was freezing a bit. So that's the reason there were a couple of hiccups. But yeah, I'm happy to take any questions if people have them.
That was so wonderful, Grant. Thank you. I can't wait for it to open back up and get up there myself. What a magical place. So we have quite a few questions for you.
Okay.
The first one is from Kay. She asks, how much land remains with the estate now?
Several hundred acres. We actually, the property extends over on the other side of the railroad tracks as well.
So that was the second part of her question. How close is it to the railroad tracks? Can you give us an idea?
About 60 feet. And the train still comes by. Now it's a train that goes between New York and Albany about twice every 2 hours. From about 6 a.m. till midnight. So
busy. Yeah. Anne asks, can you tell us anything about the buffet in the dining room?
Yes, a New York piece, I believe attributed to Duncan Fife. Again, like I said, Dick really concentrated his collecting focus on classical New York furniture, and we're fortunate to have, you know, what he amassed as the largest private collection of Duncan Fife pieces. And yeah, it's an amazing New York piece.
But. Oh, wow. So you obviously had a lot of interaction with Edgewater and the property. Do you have a favorite spot? Can you tell, is that your favorite spot or?
There's too many to pick a favorite. And what's amazing is when I was, again, up there a couple weeks ago, there was a bald eagle roosting in one of the trees by the house. And to just see this, you know, bald eagle take flight and fly out over the Hudson, it was amazing to see. But, wow. But yeah, no, there's not a bad view from any part of that house on it, because you've got the river, you've got the mountains, and it's basically surrounded by a Hudson River landscape painting. And it's just phenomenal. And it's phenomenal all seasons of the year too. I know Dick would prefer to be up there, I believe, spring through summer. Once it started getting into fall, they would go to one of their other houses, but it's equally pretty in the wintertime to see the images of big ice flow, you know, blocks of ice floating by in the Hudson. And
I can't even imagine. I can't imagine living in a place like that. That sounds gorgeous. Ginger asks, once open to the public again, what type of schedule do you anticipate?
I would just say, just keep checking on our website, all that sort of information about when the house reopens, that sort of thing, and how that will all be posted on the website. So just keep checking back for that.
Grant, I just want to thank you again for joining us and sharing Edgewater with us. Gave us all a wonderful mental vacation from our homes where we've been. And you're going to be joining us later this summer, correct? For another talk.
Yes. Yeah. Y'all are stuck with me for, in July, I'm going to be focusing on Milford, which is our property in Sumter County, South Carolina. So a very interesting story associated with that property as well. So looking forward to that one too.
We can't wait to hear it. Thank you guys for joining us this evening. We hope that you will join us again in July to hear about our next lecture. And in the meantime, as many of you have asked, this is being recorded. It will be shared to our YouTube channel so you can check it out again. And while you're there, go check out Grant's talk about air mount because it was wonderful as well. Thank you all. Have a wonderful evening.
Thank you.